Hello friends, welcome back to Solid Design Principle video series. This is the last part of this video series, and in this video I'm going to discuss dependency inversion principle with examples. Please watch our previous video where we discussed interface segregation principle. The letter D in Solid stands for dependency inversion principle, which is also known as DIP. As part of this video, we are going to discuss the following pointers. First, we will discuss what is dependency inversion principle. Then we will see an example without implementing the dependency inversion principle. Then we will see what are the problems we are getting if we are not following the dependency inversion principle. Then we will see an example which is following the dependency inversion principle. And finally, we will see the advantages of using dependency inversion principle. Let us first understand the basic definition of dependency inversion principle. The dependency inversion principle states that high-level modules or classes should not depend on low-level modules or classes. Both should depend upon abstractions. Secondly, abstractions should not depend on details. Details should depend upon abstractions. The most important point that you need to keep in mind while developing real-time applications is always try to keep the high-level model and low-level model as loosely coupled as possible. The reason is when a class knows about the design and the implementation of another class, it raises the risk that if you do any changes to one class, will break the other class as well. So we should keep these high-level and low-level models or classes loosely coupled as much as possible. To do that, what we need to do is we need to make both of them dependent on abstraction instead of knowing each other. Let us understand dependency inversion principle in Csharp with an example. We'll implement one example where the employee data access class going to provide the employee details. We have also employee business logic class, which we'll call the employee data access method to get the employee details. So let's move to Visual Studio Editor. So far what I have done is I have created one console application with the name DIP into our existing solid design principle, right? Then I have made this project as the startup project. Then I have created few class files. Let us understand these class files one by one. First, I created the employee class file, and inside this employee class file, I have added few properties, right? ID, name, department, salary. These are the properties I have added inside the employee class. This employee class is going to be our model, and this model is going to hold the employee data. Then I have created another class file with the name employee data access. As you can see, this employee data access class having one method, that is get employee details. This method taking the employee ID, and it will returning the employee information based on the ID. In real time, you will get the employee details from database, but here I have hard coded the employee details. Then I have created another class with the name data access factory. As you can see, this class file having one static method, that is get employee data access object. This static method is going to return an object of employee data access class, right? So this is our employee data access class, and this data access factory class will return the employee data access object, right? So as this is a static class, we can call this method by using the class name. Then I created another class file with the name employee business logic. As you can see in the below code, this class has one constructor that is used to create an instance of employee data access class. Here within the constructor, we'll call the get employee data access object, we'll call the get employee data access obj method on the data access factory class, right? So this class, this method will return an instance, and we are initializing this employee data access variable with the return instance. We have also one method, that is get employee details by ID, which is used to call The getEmployeeDetails method on the EmployeeDataAccess object to get the employee details. Let us compare this example with the definition of dependency inversion principle. As per the dependency inversion principle definition, a high-level model should not depend on low-level model. Both should depend on abstraction. So let us first understand what do we mean by high-level model and what do we mean by low-level model. A high-level model is a model that always depends on other models. So in our example, the employee business logic class depends on employee data access class to get the employee details. So here the employee business logic class is the high level model and employee data access class is the low level model. As per the first rule of dependency inversion principle, the employee business logic class or model should not depend on the concrete employee data access class or model. Instead, both the classes should depend on abstraction. In our example, high level model or class depends on low level model or class. That means there is some design issue. The second rule of dependency inversion principle states that abstraction should not depend on details. Details should depend on abstractions, right? So before understanding this point, let us understand what do you mean by abstraction. In simple words, we can say that abstraction means something which is non-concrete. So abstraction in programming means we need to create either an interface or abstract class which is non-concrete so that we cannot create an instance of it. In our example, the employee business logic and employee data access are concrete classes. That means we can create objects of it. As per dependency inversion principle, the employee business logic, that is high level model, should not depend on concrete employee data access, that is low level model. Both classes should depend on abstraction, meaning both classes should depend on either an interface or an abstract class. Then the question that should comes to your mind, what should be in the interface or in the abstract class? As you can see in our example, the employee business logic uses the getEmployeeDetails method of employee data access class. In real time, there will be many employee related methods in the employee data access class. So we need to declare employee getDetails method within an interface. So if you look at the code, right, the employee data access class currently having one method, that is getEmployeeDetails method. But in real time, there may be many methods, that is getAllEmployeeDetails, addEmployee, deleteEmployee, updateEmployee, right? So whatever operations you have in employee data access class, those operations are going to be defined within an interface, right? So let us create an interface and let's see how we can implement this. So what I have done is I have created an interface, that is IEmployeeDataAccess, and I have defined one method, that is getEmployeeDetails, right? So this is the interface, right? Next, we need to implement this interface within the EmployeeDataAccess class, right? Next, we need to implement the IEmployeeDataAccess in EmployeeDataAccess class. So what we need to do, we need to implement the IEmployeeDataAccess class here, right? So now employee data access class inherited from the IEmployee data access class, as IEmployee data access is an interface and this interface having one method, that is getEmployeeDetails, and this method is implemented, right? Next, we need to modify the data access factory class. We need to change the return type of this method as IEmployee data access instead of the employee data access, right? So now this class returning an instance of employee data access object, but it is not returning employee data access. Instead, the return type is the interface name, that is IEmployeeDataAccess data access. Next, we need to modify the employee business logic, right? Now, as you can see, we are getting one error here. The reason is Previously, this method returning employee data access, but now it is returning I employee data access. So we need to modify the return. So we need to modify the type as employee data access. And once we modify the type as employee data access, the error is gone. Now, if you look at the employee data, now if you look at the employee business logic class, then you will not find employee data access anywhere, right? So we have implemented the dependency inversion principle in our example, where the high level model, that is employee business logic, and the low level model, that is employee data access class, depends on abstraction, that is I employee data access, right? And abstraction, that is I employee data access, doesn't depend on the implementation, that is employee data access, rather details, that is employee data access, depends on abstraction, that is I employee data access. Now I hope you understand dependency inversion principle. What are the advantages of implementing dependency inversion principle? Now, the employee business logic and employee data access classes are loosely coupled classes, because employee business logic doesn't depend on concrete employee data access class. Instead, it includes a reference of I employee data access interface. So now we can easily use another class that implements employee data access with a different implementation. What next? This is the end of this video series. Here in this video, I tried to explain dependency inversion principle with examples. I hope you enjoy this video. Next, I am planning to make video series of design patterns, so keep watching. In case you need the text version of this video, then the link for the same is provided in the video description section. Thank you for watching.